refreshments that we will present in the last session. Amanda.
Amen.
This session, the topic of this section is where has the black working class gone? As a preamble, I think we know of a chorus of a revolutionary song that was sang in the 80s and early 1990s. That sums up the commitment of the people against the struggle against apartheid. I'm not sure if people will remember it. It's song will, I'm vocally wounded, but I will try. It will go like, Kabane, Kabane, Ziyolo, Ziyolo, Zalom Shaba. But that song loosely translated, it was saying, comrades, let us for this moment forget about the luxurious lifestyle and comfort, and let us forget about the luxurious lifestyle and comforts of the world and concentrate on the liberation of South Africa. So Qabane is Yolo Zalomhlaba masiziyeke okwethutyana. That's what the song said. Now, to be an activist during apartheid era meant one was sacrificing his life for the struggle against apartheid and freedom of black South Africans. One could be detained, tortured, disappear without trace, or at times face death. The middle class activists sacrificed careers and comfort to ensure that we are free today. For example, Nelson Mandela and Orr Tambo had a very successful law firm which saves the whole South Africa. They compromised their law firm for the sake of the struggle. They did not get opportunity to spend time with their young wives and their children. This sacrifice was to ensure that we are enjoying the freedom we are having today. Again, Dr. Ibi Xuma used his personal funds to resuscitate the ANC. We know of Dr. Jace Moroka, who used the money from his surgery to resuscitate the ANC. We know of the work of Dr. Modiri Mulembe and Mafikeng, what he did with the money from his surgery to resuscitate the ANC. We know of a lawyer, Griffith Mukwege, who was stabbed to death for his contribution to the struggle. The list is long and others will never be mentioned by the annals of history. But today, the middle class does not face the same dangers that were faced by the likes of Orr Tambo, Mandela, Lembede, Nkomo, David Webster, Robert Sobukwe, Griffith Mkanga, and others. The current middle class has not taken its rightful position, both in the ANC and in society in general. I argue that neglecting the middle class as a strategic strata in South African society could be suicidal and may reverse the gains of the revolution or prolong the route to achieving a prosperous South Africa as we envisage in the National Democratic Revolution and the National Development Plan. If as an organization we think that the middle class has become apathetic and reactionary, the ANC is a leader of society. We need to engage the middle class and avoid the scenarios of Nicaragua and Zimbabwe, which we'll talk about. For us to obtain, for us to move South Africa forward, to attain the goals of the NDR, to have prosperous South Africa, and to achieve the goals that we have set ourselves in the NDR, engaging middle class is key and should be prioritized by the structures of the movement at all levels. When asked by a journalist in June 2014 if the black middle class is ungrateful to the ANC, the SG of the ANC responded, open quote, "It is not about being ungrateful. That is why we put responsibility on the ANC to explain itself to the constituents. If it is not doing that, we can't blame the constituents for being ungrateful. If we engage properly, we'll be able to influence various strains of society." Close quote. But then, as we've spoken in the previous session, on any topic we discuss, we look at the historical perspectives. And I think we've got people from the party here, they will tell you that you must have historical and dialectical materialism on issues. So let's look at the black middle class and the ANC. Let's go historical. But then let's first describe or define the middle class. The simple definition of the middle class is that the middle class is a socio-economic class between the working class and the upper class. According to Marxist theory, middle class is below the ruling class and above the proletariat. But Wikipedia, when you Google, describes the middle class as a class of people in the middle of social hierarchy. For the purpose of our discussion, we'll define the middle class as defined by a simple definition of Wikipedia and further include professionals and black upper class people. So we'll say the middle class is a class of people in the middle of social hierarchy. Now, since the 2009 general elections, analysts, academics, opposition parties, and the press always falsely predict that the ANC will lose the bulk of the middle class on the elections. But the trend shows that the black middle class overwhelmingly vote for the ANC, or when the middle class is dissatisfied, they simply abstain from voting. The loyal behavior of the middle class to the ANC and the black middle class abstaining rather than voting against the ANC has had academics, analysts, and media, and opposition parties puzzled. Why is the middle class not punishing the ANC? No, they get puzzled. But because here in this lecture, we understand the historical perspective of the middle class, we have the answer. Why is the black middle class not abandoning the ANC? Now, the black middle class is loyal to the ANC due to historic reasons. One, ANC was formed mostly by the black middle class. It was formed by doctors, lawyers, and academics, etc. So the ANC is in the DNA of the black middle class. It is the black middle class who took baton from the traditional leadership after the defeat of the African kingdoms by the colonialists in the late 1800s. I will further argue that the traditional leadership was the first black elite and therefore a middle class. And they were the first people to confront the colonizers. So I'll say that we should therefore say that the traditional leadership like King Mushoeshoe, Chief Mankurwane, King Magama, Kajwayo, we term them the middle class of that era. So they were the first people to confront the apartheid system. In 1947, we know also that the people who formed the ANC, as we said in the previous section, were four lawyers who were educated overseas. So the ANC was formed by the middle class. In the 1940s, another group of young middle class changed the course of history and vowed for freedom in their lifetime. So the middle class of the 1940s said, freedom in our lifetime. The middle class of the 1940s, they were radical, selfless, and highly educated. That group included the likes of Nelson Mandela, O.R. Tambo, A.P. Mda, Zamindlela Konto, Albert Letele, Bidan Tite, Dilizi Ndaba Nji, David Bubabe, Godfrey Pitje, Victor Mbogo, Patrick Mulau, Congress Mbata, Dan Krume, Jordan Mbwane, Big Volma Sigela, and many other more educated young people in that era. Now, the relations between the middle class and the ANC are therefore historical, and the lack of appreciating the reasons why the black middle class supports the ANC shows ignorance on those who are puzzled by the black middle class support of the ANC. Since we know that the black middle class does not desert the ANC in the elections, we should be asking ourselves if the fact that the middle class has historical ties with the ANC is enough on its own to guarantee electoral support for future elections. Does the middle class participate in the ANC internal processes of the ANC adequately? Is the ANC still a home of the black middle class? Is the current middle class playing a similar role played historically by its predecessors and elites? Is the ANC ensuring that our middle class is conscious? And what should the ANC be doing to improve the role of the black middle class in the ANC and in society in general? Now, in an interview with City Press, published on the 15th of June 2014, the SG of the ANC, Comrade Bedema Tashe, made the following important points on the issue of the pregnancy of the middle class. The first point was that he said the starting point is that it is important for the middle class to understand that they are beneficiaries of progressive policies of the ANC. The middle class is selling a very mobile and portable commodity called knowledge and skill. We should engage them, raise their level of consciousness so that when they take decisions, it is not on basis of one issue. So we should have a conscious middle class. One journalist says to Comrade Bedeman Tashe, but the black middle class is a very small proportion of the electorate. Why is it important for the ANC? The SG responded, the black middle class is not small. Any revolution falls or stands on its ability to generate its own intellectual capacity. We need intellectual capacity for South Africa to move forward. If the intellectual capacity revolves, there's a bigger impact, just numbers. There's a bigger impact more than just numbers. So Comrade Bedeman Tashe was dispelling the notion that the journalists were saying, no, these people are very few, why don't you leave them? But then he said, if the middle class leaves the ANC, the ANC's intellectual capacity will degenerate. He further said, we describe the forces of revolution as those who stand to benefit from change and those who are prepared to defend the change. The middle class are beneficiaries of change. They must be able to defend it. If they vote for anybody else, it should not be because they are revolting because of an incident. They must do so consciously and appreciate that they agree with different policies. I find it strange for someone in the black middle class to neglect a party that promotes BEE and employment equity and go to a party that says it should be all about ability, that these policies should end. Again, the SG speaking at the Progressive Business Forum on March 2014 said, South Africa's continued social and economic progress depends on the contribution of private business and the middle class. The middle class must stop complaining, must make things happen. This is why we say together we move SA forward. It is about the middle class understanding that it is their responsibility to make it happen. If you don't, nothing will happen. Those who benefit from the gains of democracy but do not contribute to advancing them could not consider themselves as a motive force. Again, in a statement of the ANC following an NEC meeting and ANC Lokota on 5 July 2014, the ANC wrote, the ANC won an overwhelming electoral majority, which demonstrates confidence from the majority of South Africans. It is of significance to our mission that 20 years post-independence, we have achieved such milestone. The discrimination is based upon historic trends of many liberation movements in the world, finding it difficult to survive beyond the 20 years. Noting our performance in some of the metros, the NEC recognized that this requires that we put greater effort in maintaining contact with and addressing the concerns of our support base. Also, the ANC must reconnect with the black middle class, which are a result of progressive policies of the ANC. Now, I will just go to the scenarios which I said we should avoid, the scenario of Nicaragua and Zimbabwe. I'll just make part of Nicaragua have similarities, as it is with many other oppressed and colonized nations. Now, I think the revolution of Nicaragua is very important for every comrade to understand. When I was part of Masupatzila, when I was a very young man, one of the first topics was the revolution of the people of Nicaragua. and later I understood why they gave us that medical education. Now, the turn of events in Zimbabwe and in Nicaragua should serve as a lesson to us when we deal with the black middle class. Now, I'll just go to the situation of Nicaragua. In 1976, the Sandinista Front of National Liberation, FSNL, which were called the Sandinistas, achieved liberation from Somoza regime and set up a revolutionary council. Now the Sandinistas were like the ANC of Nicaragua. Now in 1984, the Sandinistas won election by 67%, must have learned that, 67%. But the Sandinistas were faced with many challenges when they took over the government. Nicaragua was impoverished, there was high rate of illiteracy, natural disasters were ravaging the country, and then there was USA-sponsored counter-revolutionary groupings, and there were economic sanctions. The Sandinista government made an era of increasing and reaching the middle class without politically educating them. Now, less than one-fifth of the population were middle class, and they were richer than everyone, with about 60% of the income going to the 20% of the population. So the Sandinistas concentrated on the middle class and reached the middle class. The new middle class benefited enormously from government policies. The middle class became arrogant, became powerful and rich. Resulted in children from lower socioeconomic backgrounds attending school for the first time. By 1990, Zimbabwe had achieved impressive results in the area of primary health and education, and Zimbabwe was the envy of all the post-colonial states. Everyone was envying Zimbabwe. Zimbabwe was also termed as a bread basket of SADC regime due to its responsibility of ensuring that there were food stocks enough for the whole SADC region. Things went wrong. In the 1990s, students protested. Student protests began. Workers started to show discontent with government. And in 1997, Zimbabwe African National Liberation Army, ZANLA, which is equivalent to MK, website, former combatants and veterans protested. Now, this was a government which was under pressure from the students, from workers, from ex-combatants. In 2000, a referendum was held. In that referendum, the liberation movement was defeated by the newly formed MDC. Soon after MDC's victory in that referendum, there was an aggressive land distribution program, and the year 2000 parliamentary elections were marked by violence. the good work of Zimbabwe's government on health, education, housing, food security were wiped away during that economic crisis and political upheavals of the late 1990s and the increase in intensity in the 2000s. Now, the Zimbabwean scenario should serve as the warning to the South African black middle class that receiving education and receiving and benefiting from government policies can easily be wiped away by political crisis. And it is dangerous to have political apartheid, to say agirite. Now, that black middle class of Zimbabwe, which was prospering, which was one of the richest in the continent, lost all that in a few years because of not being politically active. Now, the Nicaraguan scenario also should serve the warning to the ANC that increasing an unconscious middle class, which becomes arrogant, can result in an electoral loss, and we may take years to retain power. Thus, and then it moved to 36.4% in 2008. So the ANC accelerated the growth of the middle class. By 2013, the number of black middle class doubled, exceeding the number of white people in the same. Taking basic students from being 150,000 students a year in universities to 950,000, to almost a million students. So that was what the ANC done in 20 years, in increasing the numbers of the middle class. Now, what are the dangers of an unconscious and apathetic middle class? Now, the first danger, according to my view, is that such middle class will flirt with attractive but unsustainable organizations. Know the organizations which are very attractive but unsustainable. They do gimmicks, you know, they do funny things in parliament, they make noise. So they are attractive but unsustainable because they are built on gimmicks. Whereas the African National Movement is built on solid grounds of NDR, Freedom Charter and the love for those of that. So that's the first danger, that we hope the middle class doesn't flirt with this attractive but unsustainable organization. Two, we hope the middle class doesn't have directional views, that is, sit at home, read newspapers and criticize. We hope the middle class doesn't become unpatriotic. Me and being unpatriotic in the manner that to say, me and my family are doing well, a nice house, a nice car, politics are a waste of time. We also hope the middle class does not lack, does not develop lack of social solidarity with the poor. So historically, the middle class, black middle class has always played solidarity with the poor. We do not want a black middle class to say the poor are lazy, they don't want to go to school, you know, we don't want that kind of middle class. We also hope that we know what to call middle class aggrandizement without political education. That is the middle class that benefits from progressive policies of the ANC, but lack political and social consciousness. Then, after they benefit from these policies, then they vote people who are against non-racialism, equitable society, and BEP, and employment equity, and self-governance of black people. So now, if the black middle class abandons the ANC, goes to other people, they'll be surprised. They'll be surprised that fewer chartered accountants will pass their board exam, fewer black doctors will be specialists, fewer lawyers will be senior counsels, and so forth and so forth. So we hope the black middle class is alive to that knowledge and avoid it. And now, what will be the way forward? We know that academic literature suggests that a white and well-developed middle class has a positive role to play in the democratization process of any country. Our own struggle shows that the middle class has always pledged solidarity with the poor and have led the revolution and the struggle since the invasion by the colonialists until freedom in 1994. So historically, we know the middle class has always pledged solidarity with the poor, have led the revolution. Now, this generation of black middle class will be acting in an ahistoric manner if they do not take the baton from its predecessors. The challenges facing South Africa requires all shoulders on the wheels and hands on deck. The ANC, as a leader of society, needs to ensure that the middle class takes its rightful position in the ANC and in society. The ANC was formed to represent black interests in South Africa. Amongst its objectives was to promote the social, educational, and political upliftment of black people. Key in the objectives of the ANC is philosophy of African nationalism. Now, it is what we should engage the black middle class on. Now, the first president of the ANC Youth League, Antoine Lembede, pointed out 6 principles of African nationalism. The first one was humanity, that people must be viewed within, which means people must be viewed within its material condition. Then he said there is a scientific basis to nationalism, which believes that every nation is unique and has a particular contribution to society. He said African nationalism must be based on history and on economic structure. He also felt that African societies are based on communality. He also suggested that African political institutions should be democratic. And then he had said African nationalism has an ethical basis in which morality is key. Now, basic lessons defines African nationalism. So it's important because this African nationalism is what African National Congress stands for. So it's important for us to understand what is African nationalism. He therefore defined African nationalism as a desire for personal emancipation, a search for equality, self for equal rights, self-respect, and full participation in society. Therefore, African nationalism is a continuous effort to rescue Africans from perceived inferiority as a result of colonialism. Hence, the black middle class must lead that. Okay, that's right. Attaining goals of the Freedom Charter, the goals of the NDR, and implementing the National Development Program requires an activist middle class. The black middle class should be in the forefront of saying never again or less to forget. Indeed, history will judge this generation of black middle class very harshly. It can judge them as spectators in the national discourse who thought things would happen by themselves. We know that things will not happen by themselves. Again, to talk to the conscience of the black middle class, we can go to what Mahatma Gandhi once said. Mahatma Gandhi once said there are seven deadly sins in the world. The first sin Mahatma Gandhi said was wealth without working. Being rich but not working. It's a problem. Pleasure without conscience. Nice. Knowledge without character. Business without morality. Science without humanity. Religion without sacrifice. Politics without principle. Now, the Afrikaner and Afrikaner man who fought the apartheid system and who was resented by the apartheid government, Om Bram Fischer, once remarked, open quote, "I owed it to the political prisoners, to the banished and the silenced, not to remain a spectator, but to act." Mm-hmm. Now, moving forward, the branches of the ANC should recruit them the middle class in numbers and note the following points. First point, must remind the middle class about its moral just, remind the middle class about the moral, just and equitable policies of the ANC. Remind the middle class about gains of the ANC. We must warn about the dangers of apartheid. Warn about dangers of being collaborationist with racist parties by being liberal or rational. Administer political education to understand organizational culture and principle. Remind the middle class about the ANC's foreign policy. Involve the black middle class in ANC subcommittees. Nominate the middle class into hospital boards, water boards, audit committees, etc. Emphasize participation in social improvement programs, in NGOs, tutoring matriculants, and so forth. Recognize that COSAS, SASCO, ANC Youth League, and YCL are strategic entry points of activist middle class. The entry point of activist middle class is the PYA. Involve the black middle class in drafting of the ANC manifesto. Engage professional bodies like Black Lawyers Association, the engineers, the health professionals, etc. When we draft policies, appoint to DETs, LETs, RETs, appoint a black middle class during election campaigns, make them attend conferences to participate in commissions. Even because we find that black middle class don't want to be part of chaotic BGMs, but then the ANC allows that you can get people to be resource people in the conferences. So it means if you know that there's a school principal or there's an educator in the region who's progressing, lobby for him to be in the commission on education. If you know there's someone who's a lawyer, who's a graduate in public administration, lobby the people who are preparing for the conference. That person must be a resource person in the commission. They are not interested to voting delegates. I tell you. Our middle class should be turned into being a motive force. And we should guide against a reactionary and pathetic middle class. together we can move South Africa forward quicker. That was the end of the first session. Yeah, the first session end. I'm given an indication that I'll chair the second session. The second session will be about the issues, contemporary politics and balance of forces. It's going to take about an hour. I'm going to introduce the speaker for the research session. But as we introduce the speaker must be aware that he's the last person standing between us and lunch. Let me introduce the speaker of the second session. His name is Mphato Milane. He's currently a principal of a school for 10 years. He has a diploma in maths and science education. He has a degree in technology education. He is currently studying towards B.Ed honors in educational law. His political profile reads as thus. He is the founding SRC secretary at Mophate Secondary School at Khotsong Township. He was a COSA secretary in 1990. He was a founding president of SACSA, which is South African Colleges SRC Association, which was aligned to SASCO. He was a founding member of the same organization nationally. He was a branch chairperson of the ANC in 2013 from 2003 to 2009. SACP Chrisane branch chairperson 2005 to 2009. ANC Youth League BEC member 2003 to 2004. He's a founding member of YCL Efasemba in the Northwest and a founding PC member of YCL in the province 2004 and 2006. He became a COSATU secretary at Daum local 2009 to 2015. Currently, he's COSATU chairperson.